Welcome to Electrical Lad. If you are new to this channel, make sure to subscribe and hit the bell icon so you don't miss any future videos. Remember, electricity is dangerous. You should always be properly trained and qualified before working on any electrical equipment. You've probably heard the terms relay, contactor, motor starter, but what do they actually mean? Are they the same thing or completely different? If you've ever been unsure, this video will finally make it clear. So, what is an electromechanical relay? At its core, an electromechanical relay is a switch that opens or closes using a magnetic coil and moving contacts, controlled by an electrical signal. A relay consists of a coil, an armature, and contacts. When we apply power to the coil, it will generate a magnetic field and pull the armature down. Armature pushes the contacts together, and the contacts act like a closed switch. Now we can use the relay to power other devices or connect its contacts to a different circuit. For instance, we could hook it up to a solenoid valve. Once the relay is powered, contacts close and power the solenoid. When it comes to relays, we need to understand normally open and normally closed contacts. Normally open means the contacts are open when the device isn't powered, and they close when it's turned on. Normally closed is the opposite. The contacts stay closed when the device isn't energized, and they open when device is activated. Finally, the electrical symbol for a relay coil represented by a round circle. Here, I'm showing you the wiring diagram for this relay. Now that we understand how a relay works, let me show you the electrical schematic for this circuit, also called a ladder diagram. It's a simple and standardized way to represent control circuits. It's called a ladder diagram because it looks like a ladder with power lines on the sides and rungs in between. On the first rung, when the switch closes, it energizes the relay coil. Then, on the second rung, the relay's normally open contact closes, and that powers the solenoid valve. So when the relay is energized, its contacts close, allowing current to flow to the solenoid. So, if a basic switch can turn things on and off, why do we even need a relay? I explain that next. There are three main reasons to use a relay. The first one is isolation. Here, I'm showing a PLC output directly connected to solenoids and a motor starter, which we'll explain in more detail later. Most PLC output cards use transistors and other electronic components. However, some cards come with built-in relay outputs. In cases where the output card doesn't have relays, directly connecting inductive loads, like solenoids or motor starters, is not a good practice. That's because inductive loads generate inrush currents and voltage spikes when they turn on or off. These spikes can damage the sensitive components inside the output card. To prevent this, it's good practice to use an external relay with low coil current. The PLC simply energizes the relay coil, and the relay's contacts are used to safely switch the solenoids or motor starter. The second reason we use a relay is to run multiple lines of logic or circuits from a single control signal. But before we dive into how that works, we need to understand how relays are arranged internally, specifically, terms like SPDT and DPDT. Here, I'm showing you a relay with two poles, meaning it can control two separate circuits. Each pole can switch between two contacts, which is why it's called double throw. Put it all together, and we call it a double-pole double-throw relay, or DPDT for short. In the same way, here I'm showing you a 4-PDT relay. That means it has four poles, so it can control four separate circuits, and each pole can switch between two contacts. That's why it's called a 4-pole double-throw relay, or 4-PDT. Now let's look at how we can use a relay to run multiple lines of logic or control multiple circuits. Take a look at this schematic. On the left, the limit switch LS1 feeds three branches through wire 21, each controlling a load, solenoid 1, solenoid 2, and relay 2. The issue here is that all the current flows through LS1, including inrush currents from these inductive loads. LS1 is a mechanical switch, not designed for high combined current, and over time, this can damage its contacts. Also, running multiple branches from a single switch may work, but it's not good practice. Now look at the improved circuit on the right. Here, the limit switch LS1 energizes a 3-PDT relay, R1. Each of our 3 normally open contacts then controls solenoid 1, solenoid 2, and relay 2 separately. This design keeps the schematic clean and well-organized. More importantly, LS1 no longer carries the total current of all 3 loads, only the coil current of R1. So what is the third reason to use a relay? Let's say you have an electronic control card that only outputs 5 volts DC. That's not enough to directly power a 110-volt AC solenoid. But by using a relay with a 5-volt coil, the card can energize the relay. Then, the relay's contacts, rated for higher voltage, can be used to switch the 110 volts to the solenoid. So now that we know what relays can do, here's a question. What if you need to control something much bigger, like a large air conditioner? That's coming up next. Contactors work like relays, but their contacts are built to handle much higher currents. They're used to connect power to large current equipment such as industrial rectifiers, electric heaters, air conditioners, and compressors. Contactors come in different configurations: single pole, 2 poles, and 3 poles. Here, I'm showing you a single pole and a 3-pole contactor. So how does a contactor work? A contactor is made up of a few key parts: a fixed iron core, a coil, a movable iron core, a return spring, fixed contacts, and movable contacts. The movable contacts are connected to the movable iron core using a non-metallic arm, so there's electrical isolation between the coil and the power contacts. When power is applied to the coil, it generates a magnetic field. This field magnetizes the fixed iron core, which pulls the movable iron core downward. As the movable core moves, it pulls the arm with it, closing the contacts. Now let's take a look at how a contactor is used in a circuit and walk through an example of how it's controlled. Here, I'm showing you a 3-pole contactor powering a 3-phase electric heater. Each of the contactor's power terminals, C1A, C1B, and C1C, is connected to each phase of the heater. When the contactor is energized, all 3 phases are connected at once, allowing the heater to operate. Now let's take a look at how this contactor is controlled to run the heater. In this example, the circuit includes a selector switch labeled heater on. As long as this switch is turned on, the control process remains active. The contactor coil is wired through a temperature switch. When the temperature drops below 250 degrees, the temperature switch closes, energizing the contactor coil and turning on the heater. Once the temperature reaches 300 degrees, the switch opens, de-energizing the contactor and shutting the heater off. This cycle continues automatically, as long as the selector switch remains in the on position. So what are auxiliary contacts? Auxiliary contacts are add-on contacts that attach to the contactor. They don't carry the main load. Instead, they're used in the control circuit. Depending on whether they're normally open or normally closed, they will switch when the main contactor is closed. They're commonly used to latch a circuit or as an interlock to trigger other parts of the logic. In our example, when contactor C1 is energized, its auxiliary contact C1-1 also closes. This closed contact completes the circuit and energizes the damper solenoid. One final note about contactors: when you're dealing with currents over 400 amps, it's recommended to use vacuum contactors. At these high current levels, there's a serious risk of arc flash during switching. Vacuum contactors solve this by sealing the arc inside a vacuum chamber. With no air or oxygen, the arc is extinguished almost instantly. That makes them not only safer, but also longer lasting. So what exactly is a motor starter? A motor starter is simply a contactor with an overload protection device attached to it. There are 2 main types of starters: those with thermal overloads and those with electronic overloads. To start a 3-phase motor, all 3 phases need to be powered simultaneously, and that's where a motor starter comes into play. It has 3 contacts that close at the same time to send power to the motor. The motor starter also includes overload protection. If the motor draws too much current beyond the set limit, the overload protection trips, cutting off power to prevent motor damage.
Don't set the overloads too high.
Never exceed 125% of the motor's full load current. For a 40 horsepower motor, this means the setting should be no higher than 50 amps. But how does a motor starter work? First, The motor starter contains three sets of contacts that deliver power to the motor. Each set of contacts consists of a stationary and a movable contact. The movable contacts are attached to the coil with non-conductive materials, like fiberglass or reinforced molded plastic. The coil typically consists of three main components: an iron core, a main coil, and springs. When the correct voltage, 120 volts AC in this case, is applied to the coil, it creates a magnetic field that draws in the iron core. This movement closes the contacts, enabling power to pass through them and the overload elements, which energizes the motor. The motor continues running until power is removed from the coil. Before we get into the 120 volt AC control side, we need to talk about two other components on the starter: the auxiliary contact and the overload contact. These will play a key role in the start-stop control circuit. The auxiliary contact is connected to the main contactor and closes at the same time. It's mainly used in the control circuit to show when the contactor is activated. It also helps latch the circuit, but I'll explain that in more detail when we get to the control circuit. An overload contact is a normally closed contact that opens when an overload occurs and needs to be manually reset using a reset button. In the control circuit, it disconnects the circuit when an overload is detected. Now let's take a look at the control circuit for our 30 horsepower motor. In its simplest form, the motor control circuit will look like this. The first component in our control circuit is the control transformer, which has primary and secondary fuses. It steps down the voltage from 480 volts to 120 volts AC, supplying power to the entire control circuit. The next set of components includes the momentary start and stop buttons. Notice the term momentary. This means the buttons are only active while being pressed. Once you release them, they return to their normal state. The stop button is normally closed, meaning it allows current to flow until pressed. The start button, on the other hand, is normally open and only completes the circuit when you press it. The next three components in the circuit are all part of the motor starter. First is the starter coil, labeled M1. Then, there's the auxiliary contact of the starter, and lastly, the normally closed overload contact. So, how does this circuit work? Let's go through that next. If you haven't subscribed yet, go ahead and hit that subscribe button and give us a thumbs up. A motor starter control circuit uses what's known as a latching circuit. A latching circuit keeps the motor starter energized even after the initial start signal is removed. It works by using one of the motor starter's normally open auxiliary contacts, which is wired in parallel with the start button. When you press the start button, it energizes the M1 coil, closing the auxiliary contact. This contact then continues to supply power to the coil even after you release the start button. The motor starter coil stays energized, or latched, until you press a separate stop button, which is wired in series with the circuit. To recap, use a relay when switching small devices or logic signals. Use a contactor for high power loads like large heaters. And use a motor starter when you need to start and protect the motor. If you want to dive deeper into motor starters, check out my video, Mastering Motor Control Basics. Thanks for watching. I hope you found this video helpful. If you did, feel free to like, subscribe, and share it with others who might be learning too. I'll see you in the next video.